Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna, we welcome you for today's Chetana program, and I would really like to thank the drama team for transporting us to Vrindavan to see the wonderful transformation of Daku Govardhan. It was really nice. I was looking forward to see the drama. Thank you very much. So the topic for today is the transformers. When we decided the topic, later on few friends of mine came and said, oh Mataji, transformers, huh? Hollywood and all. So I'm too far from those things. I didn't know anything about the movie Transformers. So I recently spoke to my nephew and he narrated me the entire story of the movie. But I really apologize to say this, that there is no connection of the movie The Transformers to today's topic. I never thought of anything in that line. So, but I assure you, the things that we are going to discuss today will also be liked by you and will be helpful to all of us. If we just pause in life and look around, we will realize that life is full of constant transformations, right? The life is very fast, so we don't ever stop to think about the transformations going on around us. But if we just think, stop, pause and see, we will see many transformations. Some go noticed, some go unnoticed. Most of the times, because some transformations are very slow. They are so slow that we don't realize. Others don't affect us. Unless any transformation affects us, we will not realize it. Okay? I just want to share one example. Just like in late 80s or even in early 90s, if you went to any shop, any grocery shop or any shop for that matter, and you purchased something, you always got it wrapped in paper, newspaper. If you want to buy rice, you went to the shop, the grocer would give you wrapped in a newspaper. They had a typical nice style of wrapping it up, okay? Anything for that matter. Even the bread came wrapped in paper. Milk came in glass bottles. And or else the doodhwala would come. But slowly, slowly, nobody realized but how slowly the plastic came in. So deeply it came that now we don't even realize that everything that we purchase comes in plastic. Okay? For many years it went on and it is going on that we are purchasing milk in plastic, bread in plastic, all the grains in plastic, everything you name and we buy wrapped in plastic. Many years have gone and lately now we are realizing that what havoc is this plastic causing to us. This entire transformation happened. It slowly happened, so we didn't notice what kind of transformation it is. And now since it is affecting us, it is affecting Mother Nature, it is affecting our aquatics, it is affecting our mother cows and means all the animals, now it is somewhere pinching and we are realizing that, oh, the transformation has happened without our notice. It is affecting us. So transformation keeps on happening. We ourselves go through so many transformations, right? We go physical transformations. When we are born Have you seen a newborn baby? A photograph? All babies look alike, okay? Only the mother can recognize her own baby. All look alike. You know how they look? They look like raisins. All shriveled up, you know, like dry fruits. But then you grow up, the face starts taking a form. People start saying, oh, mummy jaisi lagti hai, ye to dadi pe gayi hai, like that, you know. And then you go, then you reach your youth, the best time of the life, you know. You look the best in these years. And then you become an adult, and again, towards the raisin stage, as you grow old, again, from raisin to raisin. So physical transformations we go on, we go through. Then we go through emotional transformations. And as a child, you're so much dependent emotionally on your parents. You know, children, when the parent is away, the child goes through something called as separation anxiety. Okay, when the child cannot see the parent around, even the child is playing in the outside room and it can't see mother around, the child goes restless. Oh, mother. The child goes through separation anxiety in the childhood, and the same child when grows into youth goes through anxiety when the parent is around. Oh, mommy is around, papa is around. No, they are not so comfortable, parents being always around, okay? Emotional transformation we go through. We go through social transformations, okay? We are a very carefree child, no worries, just enjoy, play and enjoy. Then as we grow, we get transformed into a very responsible student. We do our studies. We grow further. We start thinking about career. You know, you become a responsible employee. You become responsible in life for yourself. And as the time goes, we become responsible for even others. You become a mother. You take responsibility of family. You take responsibility of children. So like that, again, socially we are transformed from carefree to so much responsible. Transformations goes on in life. There are organic, natural transformation. Everybody goes through. You don't have a choice. You don't have to make a choice. Oh, I don't want to grow like this. I don't want this to happen to me. They are transformation which naturally happen with everybody, with living entities, with non-living entities. Animals go through transformations, human beings go through transformation. But human being has a peculiar facility, is that other than the natural transformations, the organic transformations, they have something called as transformation by choice. Have you realized? None of the animals can go through the transformation by their choice. You will not see a mosquito deciding that from today I'll eat only fruits, no biting, because I've heard that troubling others is not good. No, it just follows the nature. Mosquito will come, it will bite and go. You will not see mosquito sucking from apple or, you know, sitting on trees and going searching for mangoes like that. It will not, because they don't have a choice. But human being has a choice. They can go through the transformation by choice. Good or bad, any transformation that you have to go through, you have to make a choice that I want to get transformed. We all know the story in Ramayana about Kaikeyi. Kaikeyi, the wife of Dashrath Maharaj, loved Lord Ram more than Kaushalya loved Lord Ram. So much love she had for Lord Ram. And when Dashrath Maharaj announced about the coronation of Lord Ram, Kaikeyi was the happiest person in Ayodhya. But Manthara, her assistant servant, came and poisoned Kaikeyi's ears. And she told her, Kaikeyi, you are mad? Why are you celebrating? And she said, Manthara, are you mad? Why are you even asking me? My dear Lord Ram is going to be the king. Why are you asking me this question? Are you mad? Manthara said, I am not mad. You are mad. Because you have lost all the sense. You are not able to think. By Lord Ram being the king, Kaushalya is going to be the mother of the king. And she is going to get all the opulence and you are going to be deprived of everything. Manthara kept poisoning Kaikai's ears. And Kaikai, what did she do? She allowed it. She allowed Manthara to poison her ears and thus poison her heart. The soft-hearted, gentle, loving Kaikai became a very selfish, hard-hearted lady. And what did she do? She asked her husband for two boons. One, that my son Bharat should become the king. And second, Ram should be banished to forest. Thus, Kaikai became the cause of the death. Her husband died. Dashrath Maharaj died in separation of Lord Ram. She became the cause of death of her own husband. She became the cause of so much of wrath of her own son Bharat. She became the cause of so much of hardship to Lord Ram, Lakshman and Mother Sita. Thus, Kaikai, since she voluntarily allowed that transformation to occur through the transformer. Who was the transformer? Manthara. Manthara became the negative transformer in Kaikai's life. Another story which comes from the scriptures is that of little Dhruva. Dhruva Maharaj was a 5-year-old child, and as any small child would want the affection from his father or his mother, Dhruva saw that his stepbrother Uttam was sitting on the lap of his father, Uttanapad Maharaj. And Dhruva wanted to just go and sit on the lap of his father. And he rushed towards his father, and his stepmother, Suruchi, said, "Stop! You desire to sit on the lap of your father? You can't just desire. You have to deserve before you desire." Okay? If you want to sit on the lap of your father, you have to make sure that you take birth from my womb. That makes you qualified. Right now, you have no qualification to sit on the lap of your father. And Dhruva was so broken, he looked at his father with great anticipation, he was looking for support. He looked at his father and his father just remained silent. He did not say anything. He did not say yes. He did not say no. But because he remained silent, Dhruva got the message. And Dhruva just turned his back. He was angry. His lips were quivering, shivering. And his body was shivering. He just ran. He ran. Where will he go now? When father is not giving any support, he ran straight to his mother. Mother had already got the news of what has happened to my son. She welcomed Dhruva, she hugged him. And Dhruva explained what he is going through. Mother, this is terrible what I am going through. Tell me some solution. And mother said, "Dhruva, though it is very unfortunate and very sad, but it is true. What your stepmother has said is true. And I can't help you." Dhruva said, "If you can't help me, who can help me?" Said, "Only the Supreme Lord can help you." And Dhruva said, "Where can I find the Supreme Lord?" She said, "I have heard that great sages find the Supreme Lord where? In the forest. They meditate on the Lord in the forest." And Dhruva heard. He was determined. "I want to meet the Supreme Lord. And I will get from him the position which is superior not only to my father, but even to my grandfather. I want a place superior to my grandfather." Who is his grandfather? Lord Brahma. "I want a place superior to Brahma also. From the place from where nobody can bring me down." Okay? And Dhruva left for the forest. He went to the forest and there came our dear Narad Muni. And he stopped Dhruva and said, "Where are you going?" He said, "I'm going to the forest." "Why?" "Oh, such and such thing has happened and I want to meet the Lord. I want to meet Lord Narayan." And Narad Muni smiled and said, "You are a small boy. Why are you taking things so seriously? don't think, take things so seriously. Go back home and relax, you know. This is not a place for you. But Dhruva was so determined. He said, my pranam to you, please tell me if you can help me. If you can help me, tell me the process. If you can't help me, Hare Krishna, let me go on my journey. And Narad Muni was really impressed with the determination of Dhruva. And he told him the process. He explained him the process through which he will achieve Lord Narayan. He gave him the mantra and he told him the process. Dhruva sat to perform austerities. 5-year-old Dhruva, you know what kind of austerities he was performing? In the first month, he was eating only dry leaves and drinking water. Next, he stopped eating the dry leaves, he was drinking only water. Next, he stopped drinking water, he was taking only air, he was only breathing. And next, he stopped breathing. He would breathe only once in a month and no air then. But when he would breathe, he would breathe so heavily, he would suck all the air from the universe and everybody else in the universe would get choked. And they all approached Narayan and said, oh Lord, please do something. This small boy, 5-year-old boy, so much of determination he has to achieve you, it is choking us. And Lord Narayan, so pleased with Dhruva, he appeared in front of him. And when Dhruva saw Narayan, all his desires were vanished. He couldn't speak anything. Narayan touched Dhruva's head with his shank, with his conch. And Dhruva spoke and offered wonderful prayers. And Lord Narayan said, ask Dhruva, you wanted from me something, right? Dhruva said, no. After seeing you, I feel that I was looking for broken pieces of glasses and now I have got a diamond. I don't want anything. Lord said, yeah, I'm very happy. But since I'm so pleased with you, I offer you that position. And we all know the Dhruva that we see in the sky, Dhruva Tara. But Dhruva's transformation we see. What was the transformation? From an angry young boy to a determined sadhaka, you know, so much of austerity, such an austere person, to a pure-hearted soul without any desires. Mother Suruchi and Narad Muni took Dhruva through these transformations, but it was ultimately Dhruva, okay, his own desire to go through the transformation. So transformers will come to us, but our willingness is very important. If we want to go through the transformations, it's our willingness is the key thing for going through the transformations. Narad Muni again once was passing by through a forest and he saw many animals half killed, you know, half dead animals. And he felt so much compassion. He was thinking, who is doing this, you know? A rabbit who is pierced by an arrow but not dead, you know, just going through the pain. A deer pierced by arrow, not dead, going through the pain. Another, many animals just half dead, you know, crying in pain. Narad Muni was feeling so much compassion. Who is doing this to them? He was going on taking out the arrows from the bodies of those animals, trying to comfort them. And there comes a hunter, a very furious hunter, and saying, oh, why are you doing this? They are my animals. I have captured them. And Narad Muni looked at him. Is that you who is doing this? He said, yes, I am Mrigari. I am doing this to them. They are my animals. And Narad Muni looked at Mrigari with the same compassion that he had for those animals. Same compassion he had for Mrigari. He said, Mrigari, why are you doing this? He said, why means this is my occupation. This is what I am trained to do. My father did it. My grandfather did it. And I am also trained in the same thing. I don't know anything else. He said, but Mrigari, do you know what these animals are going through? the reaction to this is awaiting you. Each and every pain that you are giving to these animals is going to come back to you. You are also going to suffer the same pain. Murugari was listening. He said, is it? Nobody told me this. And Narad Muni, by his power, made the Murugari see the entire movie of his future life. You know, he showed him full movie, what is awaiting him. And when Murugari saw that, he was taken aback. Oh, is it? Is this what is going to happen to me? So he folded his hands and said, oh, sage, please tell me, how can I save myself from this? And Narad Muni said, first you do one thing, break your bow and throw it aside. Murugari said, break the bow? But I don't know anything else than hunting. And we all know that forest is not a place where there are many job opportunities, that he gives up this and finds many other jobs. But he had faith. Narad Muni said, just do what I'm saying. He broke the bow. Radha Gopinath. He broke the bow and threw it aside. Narad Muni said, you sit at one place and start chanting the holy names. Murugari followed. From that day, he stopped hunting. He started chanting the holy names. He started living a very clean life, very pure life. And the villagers from the nearby area, they heard about this transformation. Oh, that hunter has become a sage. He has become a saint now. Everybody started coming, carrying food for him, carrying fruits for him, cooked food for him, you know, and offering to him. He didn't have to do anything. So Murugari was taken care. After a few years, Narad Muni was traveling in space with one of his friends, Parvat Muni. And Narad Muni said, oh, in this area, I have one disciple, Murugari. Let's go and meet him. And Narad Muni and Parvat Muni came down where Murugari was. And Murugari saw his guru. And he was so happy. He wanted to receive his guru. He wanted to go and fall at his feet. So Murugari started running towards Narad Muni. But as he was running, he was not running straight. He was jumping. He was going crisscross. And then he would go slow. And then he would jump. And he would go. And finally he reached Narad Muni. And Narad Muni and Parvat Muni, they asked him, Murugari, tell us one thing. When you were running, why were you running so funnily? You are jumping and you are falling and then you are getting slow and then you are going fast. What was it? And Murugari said, actually when I was running, there were many ants. And I didn't want to hurt them. I didn't want to kill them. How can I crush them under my feet? And that's why I was running like this, my Gurudev. And Narad Muni said, just see this transformation. At a point, Murugari was a person who enjoyed. His enjoyment was to see the animals suffer to death. You know, half kill them and then enjoy seeing them suffer to death. You know, so much of transformation. Similar story, if you have heard of Ratnakar, another dacoit, you know. He was a highway robber. He would rob people, kill people, those who were passing through that forest. And once Narad Muni was passing through the forest and Ratnakar stopped him and said, give me whatever you want, whatever you have. Narad Muni looked at him and said, actually, I don't have anything to give you and you cannot take anything, you know, from me. So he said, why? He said, because I don't have any material possessions that you can rob away from. He said, but of course, Ratnakar was actually struck with wonder to see such a confident, fearless soul, you know. Nobody had spoken to him like this. He said, Ratnakar, but I want to ask you some questions. You are doing this robbery. You are killing people. For what? For whom are you doing this? He said, oh, for my family, for my wife, my children, my parents. He said, yes, but you know, by doing this, these actions, you are actually inviting very severe reactions for yourself. Do you know that? Do you feel your parents and your wife, your children will share your karma, will share the reactions? He said, of course, yes. He said, no, go and check. Ratnakar went, asked his wife, my dear wife, I'm doing so much for you. Will you share the reactions to my karma? Wife said, no, of course not. You are doing it. If you are doing it, you will take the karma. You will share the reaction. We can't share. Neither can my kids share. With a lot of hope, he went to his parents. He said, you are my parents. You have trained me. You have raised me. I love you so much. Will you share the reaction to my actions? He said, no, child, we can't. Your karma, the reactions, you have to share. And Ratnakar was shocked. He ran to Narad Muni and said, oh, sage, now I know that I am the one who is committing the sin and I am the one who is going to suffer. Is there any way I can be rid of this? I want to get transformed. Can I? Is there any hope? Narad Muni said, yes. Stop what you are doing now and start chanting the names of Lord Ram. Chant Ram. And he said, no, I'm not able to chant. Narad Muni said, say Ram. He said, can we all say Ram? Ram. Ram. It's easy, right? But it was not easy for Ratnakar. He couldn't say Ram. So Narad Muni thought of an idea. He said, okay, you have been killing people, so maybe you are used to the word Mara. Mara, Mara. Say Mara. He said, Mara. I said, I can say Mara. So Narad Muni said, you continuously say Mara, 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 Ram, 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 Ram. Ha, he got Ratnakar to chant the names of Lord Ram. And Ratnakar sat at one place and started chanting the names of Lord Ram. Ram, Ram, Ram. Years went by and Ratnakar was completely transformed. You know who is this? Which is this story? Whose story is this? This is a story of Valmiki Muni. You know, chanting the names of Lord Ram, he achieved the perfection of his life and he gave us the epic Ramayana. And till this date, Ramayana has been transforming so many lives and it will keep transforming so many lives. Such a wonderful transformation, you know, holy name changed Ratnakar's life. Though time is less, but I want to tell you a very nice story. There was a lion cub, who was once lost. And he got mixed amongst a herd of sheep. And he started staying with them. And he just became like them. He started behaving like other sheep. He would go grazing with them. He would bray with them in a similar voice. And he would be just like them. If another wild animal ever roared, he would run in fear. This our small little lion cub had almost become a sheep. He was transformed into a sheep because he was staying with sheep. Once a lion came chasing this herd of sheep. And as he was chasing, he saw our little lion also running with the sheep. And this lion said, hey, what is my friend doing here? And why is he running away? And why is he with sheep? And he stopped chasing the sheep and he started chasing that lion, you know. And somehow he got him. And he said, stop. And this little lion said, no, please, let me go. He said, no, you stop, you fool. He said, oh, yeah, I'm a fool, but let me go. All my sheep have gone. He said, fool, you're not a sheep. No, I'm a sheep. Are you are not a sheep. No, no, I'm a sheep. Please let me go. I said, no, I'll not let you go and you come with me. So, okay. Oh, you will not harm me. No, no, I promise I'll not harm you. You come with me. So he took him to a pond. Okay, he said, now look at your reflection. And he looked at the reflection. He said, oh, there is a lion inside. He said, fool, it's not a lion, it's you. And then this lion, small lion, looked and he waved a paw like that. He waved this paw. He said, oh, that's me. I look like you. He said, of course, you're a lion, you look like me. He said, oh. He said, now roar. He said, oh, I can't roar. I'm very scared. He said, fool, you're scared because you think you're a sheep. But you're a lion. He said, oh, really? And with great courage and effort, he roared. Oh. He said, oh, I can roar. I'm a lion. I said, yes, you're wasting your life acting like sheep, you know. You're a lion. He said, yes. I was so grateful. He said, thank you so much. And now I don't have to fear any more lions. He said, yes, you are meant to be a king of the forest. And you're living like a sheep. And he was very gratefully expressed his gratitude, you know. So this is what life is about, you know. We are thinking us to be something else. And behaving like something else, trying to be someone else, forgetting about who we are. Our dear Srila Prabhupada, the founder acharya of ISKCON, traveled to America. You know what was his age? 70-year-old Prabhupada. He traveled, not by flight, traveled on a cargo ship. On a cargo ship, he suffered heart attacks, suffered seasickness. Enduring all that, he reached America. To stay in a 5-star hotel? No. In a Bowery in New York. You know what is a Bowery? You know? It's the worst place to stay. All the condemned activities happen there. Okay? Such a pure-hearted Vaishnava landed at such a place, a condemned place. At that time, the hippie movement was going on at its peak. Hippies were the youngsters who had left their parents, left the home, left their culture in search of happiness, in search of love. But they didn't know where to find. They were trying to look for happiness and pleasure in all the illicit activities. They were taking drugs. They were having illicit relationships with other opposite sex. And they were doing all the things which no sane man should do. Prabhupada felt so much compassion for them. Prabhupada stayed with them. Prabhupada wanted to share with them the message of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. Prabhupada would speak to them the message of Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada would cook for them. He would clean for them. They would come, they would eat, they would listen to him. And slowly, Prabhupada's love and the message of Bhagavad Gita started transforming their hearts. You know, slowly, slowly, they started helping Srila Prabhupada in cleaning, in winding up. You know, they started doing rendering services. They started leading pure life. They stopped eating bad food. They stopped taking drugs. They stopped having illicit relationships. And they were totally transformed human beings. So much they got transformed that they themselves became transformers. They started taking the message of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam to many others. To many others to transform them. Srila Prabhupada has written many books and there are countless stories how these books have transformed so many people's lives. You know, there was a person who wanted to commit suicide. It is a story of in the Western world. So he had locked himself in a car. He thought he will suffocate himself in a car and he will die. Okay, so he locked the car and he was sitting. And by Lord's arrangement, a devotee came there distributing books. And now this devotee did not know what this man is doing inside the car. But he started showing this person the book from the window, from the front glass, like that, book, book, book. And this person ignored. But this devotee won't go, you know. He was determined, I want to give him the book. Book, book, Bhagavad Gita, please take, like that. So he just rolled down. He wanted the devotee to go away. So he said, let me take the book and this person will leave me, you know. He rolled down the glass and said, what is this book about? He said, this book is about how to live and how to die. So, how to die? Give me the book. So he gave him the money. He again rolled up the window. He thought, now I will read. Anyways, I have to die. Let me see how to die. Now he started reading Bhagavad Gita. And as he kept on reading the shlokas and the Prabhupada's purports, his heart started getting transformed. His heart was getting changed. He rolled down his window, started the engine, cancelled the plan, went straight to the temple, became a devotee. No, there are countless stories like this. Once on the Malad station, one criminal, you know, he saw devotees distributing books. Somehow he was inspired, purchased a book, went, read the book, went straight to the police station, surrendered. So these kind of transformations, you know, happen. Life is about transformations. If we are not willing to get transformed, human life is as good as being like animals, right? Rasika Radha, what time is... Okay. We'll just, since the time is up, we'll skip a few more stories that we had. But... yes, we can say that we all want the world to be a better place, right? We always say the world should be a better place, the world should be a better place. How the world can be a better place? Who makes the world a better place? Better individuals, right? We want individuals to turn into better human beings. Unless we turn into better human beings, the world will not be transformed into a better place. We ourselves have to get transformed, and we want to become the instrument of transformation for others. And what is the best way to get transformed? Spiritual culture is the best way to transform ourselves and to help others get transformed. Why? Because spiritual culture drives away the evil from our heart. It drives away the evil of selfishness and exploitative mentality. If we follow this culture, we will stop exploiting the environment, Mother Nature. We stop exploiting the fellow human beings, animals, for our selfish motives. And it also brings about the best in us. The compassion, the loving nature, the helping nature. The spiritual culture is the best transformer. So, if we adopt... we go through the transformation, we can help many others go through the transformation. Now, thank you very much. And we are going to have, this is the month of Kartik, very special month. And we are going to have Damodar Ashtakam. Please wait and offer the ghee lamp to the Lord. And Lord's mercy will definitely transform our hearts. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Mataji.